Welcome back, everyone, to another edition of Seahawk Central News, the top source for UNCW's campus news, entertainment, and sports. I'm Janae Randall.
And I'm Sarah Lively, reminding you that as Thanksgiving draws near, you can always stay tuned to Seahawk Central News, which is available 24/7 online at youtube.com/TealTV2010.
This week, you will learn about downtown Wilmington's Farmers Market. You will also get to hear what some students are thankful for on this week's Talk on the Walk.
We will also catch you up on sports with Ben Tyson and the rest of the Seahawks sports team, along with the latest movie reviews with Chris Vickery.
Seahawks Central News starts right now. Two UNCW students proved that making a difference is worth all the while as they train mobility service dogs. Our reporter Aaron Roberts has the story.
Meet Sebastian, a year-and-a-half-old Labradoodle that lives on campus with sophomore Megan Creighton. Sebastian is part of Carolina Canines, which trains mobility service dogs.
And we have puppies that we take, and they're donated from breeders, and then they spend years in training, and I'm his puppy and tweener trainer, and after that he goes to advanced training, and then he's going to be placed with someone, and he can do all these tests to help them with mobility in their life so that they can lead more independent lives and not be dependent on other people to help them get around and do their daily tasks.
Megan isn't the only student on campus taking part in this rewarding opportunity. Next is Callan and her dog in training, Schaefer.
Callie, can you tell us how you managed to juggle both school and training?
For this particular program, it's actually pretty easy. Schaefer is in the very early parts of training right now, so it does take a little bit more work. But once they're a little bit older and well-adjusted, it's easier to balance the two things because you can actually bring them to classes with you, and it's easier to manage having a dog when they're right there by your side.
Being a full-time student can be hard, but both Megan and Callan have found a way to add a friendly pet to their family. I'm Erin Roberts with Seahawks Central News, TLTV.
Sigma 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 held their 12th annual Rockathon last week on campus. I spoke with philanthropy chair Bree Golden, who gave me some information about their event. Sisters continuously rocked in rocking chairs that different member classes decorated, while also encouraging others to buy raffle tickets and play games. Three student DJs provided entertainment, and all campus fraternities and sororities participated in penny wars. The Rockathon was able to raise around $1,350 for the Sigma 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 Foundation, specifically the Robbie Page Memorial. These funds have gone on to build play atriums in both UNC Chapel Hill and the Dallas-Fort Worth Children's Hospitals. For the first time in January, the Sisters of UNCW's Sigma chapter will be going to visit the children at UNC Chapel Hill's Children's Hospital to see the play atrium their philanthropy has helped build. They will also be distributing goodie bags to patients that were made during recruitment. Sigma appreciates all the participation and support of UNCW's campus and community.
Filmmakers from all over the world united for the 17th annual Kookalorris Film Festival last weekend. This non-competitive festival is held each November in downtown Wilmington and gives artists the chance to showcase their work. Screenings of over 100 independent and international films are shown in venues such as Thalian Hall, the City Stage Theater, and Django's Playhouse. Our reporter Jill Capodanno discusses this year's festival in an exclusive interview with the technical supervisor of Django's Playhouse, Brandon Smith.
I'm here at Django's Playhouse for the 17th annual Kookalorris Film Festival, where independent filmmakers get to show off their shorts and features for audiences' enjoyment in a non-competitive atmosphere. Let's take a look at this festival and get an interview with Brandon Smith, the technical director.
We have like a lot of filmmakers coming we have one filmmaker from Poland. We got a couple filmmakers from England coming over. Some coming from the other side of this country, coming from the north. Like it's just everyone just like comes, and like some of them are just like coming just because they love the festival itself. And a lot of filmmakers that are here right now, from what I've heard, like I've talked to a bunch of them. We got some like known celebrities here as well, but we also have like a lot of great up and coming filmmakers too. That they just honestly they love Wilmington for what it is right now. now, and they love the fact that Kukulorus, like, just like how our hospitality is just amazing, that like we take care of them and they absolutely love it. They've honestly said that this is the best film festival that they've been to in like years. Like for their film, like they've been to several before, this is their favorite so far.
If you couldn't make it to Kukulorus this year, I hope you make an effort to come out next year. It certainly is an event for everyone to enjoy, no matter what your age or where you're from. There's something for everyone. I'm Jill Capitano, Seahawks Central News, TLTV.
Now let's go outside and see what's up with Rachel Nagel on this week's Talk on the Walk. Rachel?
I'm out here on Chancellor's Walk, and as Thanksgiving approaches, I want to find out from my fellow students what they're looking forward to, what foods they're so excited to eat, and what they're thankful for this year.
The first thing I'm thankful for is my husband just got back from Afghanistan safely. So I'm thankful for that, and I'm thankful for my family back in Ohio. My plans are going to Ohio, so I'm really excited.
I'm thankful for my family on Thanksgiving, and I can't wait to get back and eat some good home cooking instead of college food. That'll be nice to have a good home meal.
I think the thing I'm most thankful for around Thanksgiving is spending time with family, getting to see relatives you haven't seen in ages, and definitely pigging out on mashed potatoes with some friends.
I'm thankful for my family and friends, and I'm very excited about being able to see a lot of them over the holidays and then start a new semester.
I'm going to Los Angeles for my Thanksgiving to see my whole Swedish family, which I'm super excited to see because I haven't seen them in over 10 months. So it's going to be great. I'm going to cook, see my doggies, and we're going to have a great time.
I'm really just thankful for my family, friends, all the awesome things I have going on in my life right now.
Whether you're thankful for your family and friends, your mother's green bean casserole, or just the end of the semester, it seems as though everybody's very excited for this coming Thanksgiving. I'm Rachel Nagel for Seahawks Central News, TLTV.
This holiday season kicks off with the 28th annual North Carolina Holiday Flotilla at Wrightsville Beach. Since 1983, dedicated volunteers have worked together to create a weekend filled with holiday events. Traditional events include illuminated ships on the Intracoastal, a festival in the park, fireworks display, live music, and much more. Each year, more than 50,000 people gather on the shores of Wrightsville Beach to view one of the top 20 must-see events in the Southeast. On Saturday, November 26th, the boat procession will begin at 6 p.m., followed by a traditional fireworks display. For more information, please visit www.ncholidayflotilla.org.
Two UNCW professors recently received the prestigious honor of being named Fulbright Scholars. Dr. Todd Berliner of the Film Studies Department and Dr. Diane Levy of the Sociology Department will be headed to different countries to teach at the beginning of 2012. TLTV had the opportunity to speak with each professor, who told us about their particular upcoming experience in the program itself. The Fulbright Scholars Program, which sends around 800 U.S. faculty and professionals abroad each year, is designed to foster American values, create presence and goodwill abroad. Dr. Berliner is headed to Eötvös Loránd University in Budapest, where he will teach American cinema and American studies as part of the Cinema Studies program. His entire family will be going, as the Fulbright office in Hungary will pay for all of his expenses while abroad. This is actually Berliner's second Fulbright scholar, the first of which he spent at the National Film School in Vietnam from 2005 to 2006. He is traveling this time as a distinguished chair, recognized as one of 30 to 40 eminent scholars around the world. Dr. Levy will be teaching at the University of Kyiv-Mohyla Academy in Kyiv, Ukraine. A former visiting Fulbright professor to UNCW encouraged her to apply and sent a letter of invitation to the university in Kyiv. She will be teaching family and American social problem courses while there from February to June. Her husband is a former Fulbrighter who encouraged her to apply and went to Germany for administration. They will be traveling together to Kyiv and look forward to the various cultural experiences.
Wilmington's film industry is getting even more recognition, this time from industry professionals. On Wednesday, November 9th, the Greater Wilmington Business Journal hosted a power breakfast series for top TV and film industry professionals at Wilmington's Convention Center. Discussion topics included the current state of Wilmington's film industry, the selection process of filming locations, and even the recent Iron Man 3 deal. The 450 audience members in attendance were able to text in their questions for the panel. This year marks Wilmington's most successful year for its industry, with more than $100 million being spent on productions.
The Center for Leadership, Education, and Services, also known as CLESS, is holding the Angel Tree program this year. Angel Tree is a fundraiser that gives presents to children that may not otherwise receive a gift this Christmas. I spoke with Taffy Supab, who is in charge of the program for CLESS. She said there are trees in Fisher Student Center, Hawk's Nest, Wagner Dining Hall, the Rec Center, Randall Library, and the Warwick Center. Students can pick an angel off of the tree for a child they would like to sponsor. An angel does not have to be hosted by one student, but can be sponsored by an entire organization as well. Donations must be in by Monday, December 5th, and CLESS will be distributing the presents the following Saturday at a party held for the children. Presents must be new and wrapped, and 80 children need hosts. Supab said she did not want to come up short and let a child down. For more information on an angel tree, please visit the CLESS office upstairs in Fisher University Union or visit the UNCW Angel Tree Facebook page.
Grow locally and shop locally. That's what Wilmington's Riverfront Farmers Market urges for consumers to enhance the quality of their lives. Reporter Laurel Cervicki has more on the story.
From free-range eggs to collard greens to homemade dog treats, the Wilmington Farmers Market has a lot to offer. But the benefits of picking up something from the market goes beyond the belly. The market's manager, Allie Callahan, says shopping here not only helps the economy, but our local farmers in our own community.
Well, coming to the market is a great sense of community, and you get to be involved with the farmer who produces your food. It's great for the environment, it's a smaller footprint, and your food's more nutritious because it hasn't spent a long time traveling.
I had the opportunity to meet with one of the farmers that Allie speaks of. Bill Moeller is the owner of Nature's Way in Hampstead, North Carolina. He says it is unique to be able to purchase things that are fresh and local in our community.
Well, one of the unique things about a farmer's market is just that. You have small local farmers within the community, and what they can offer to the public is one, fresh and local. Also, the customer can interchange with the actual farmer and find out how, where, and the process of making their product. And, you know, I always use the analogy, you know, why buy a tomato that's grown 3,000 miles when you can get it within 5 miles of your own town?
I'm Laurel Cervicki here reporting at Riverside Local Farmers Market for Seahawk Central News Teal TV.
Occupy Wilmington members made their way to downtown Wilmington. Last weekend, members held a peaceful protest on the steps of Thalian Hall. Here is reporter Jill Capodanno as she speaks with several supporters of the movement.
I'm here in front of Thalian Hall, where a group of individuals have come out to make their voices heard in Occupy Wilmington. They are specifically focusing on our government system and the struggles of the middle class. Let's see what they have to say.
As a student, I think that this movement is about our generation. It's about our generation making a difference in the world and changing the way our political system works. I think the way our political system works now is that it's limiting opportunities for people like us, especially getting out of college. We want to be able to find jobs, but corporations have such a control over the market that there's no competition and there's limited jobs now because of it. So that's why I'm here, is because I want to make a difference in that. I want to ensure that our future is sustained by the fact that we can actually have a voice in our government. We can say what we want to have changed and it'll be changed. And I think that's the most important thing about this movement.
Everyone feels like they're forced into this mold. They're forced into credit, into debt. They're controlled by finance. They feel like they're trapped, really. So right now, there's a lot of people that feel this burden, and I think really to say, you know, we're tied into it, we're laced in it, we're forced to conform to something that's not right, that's not natural, is a strong message, and it's one that I think this outfit gets across. The skirt is also layered with all different messages that all came from various Occupy events that have happened in Wilmington and around the world, because I think there's some really strong messages, and getting those all in one place and showing that's leading up to us getting free of this burden of being tied down is really important, and I think that's a really strong symbolism.
We've heard a lot of opinions today, and I hope that through these opinions, you've been inspired to have your voice be heard somehow. I'm Jill Capodanno, Seahawk Central News, Teal TV.
Now let's head over to the sports desk and check up with Ben Tyson and the rest of Seahawk sports team.
Hi there, folks. Welcome to the new haircut edition of the Seahawks Sports Report. Let's get right into things on campus with the men's basketball team, who geared up to go for preseason win number 2 on November 6th. Sway Thompson has a report.
Welcome to Travis Collins Stadium, where the Seahawks are taking on the 2009 CIAA champion, St. Augustine Falcons. This is the final exhibition game before the season opener. Here are the highlights.
And Matt Wilson hands it off to Adam Smith, who takes it from downtown, and it is all water. Before he gets it again, takes it over to the corner and pulls up and drains it once again. He is on fire. And Trevor Deloach accidentally fouls Nick Chamberlain from behind three, giving up the four-point play. Before Freddie Jackson comes down, dishes it to Adam Smith, who pulls up for the mid-range jumper, and it is good. And the final play of the game, Craig Ponder dishes to Cedric Williams, who dunks it home. Adam Smith was the high man with 20 points to lead all scorers.
The Seahawks had a hard time getting anything to go down, but managed to hold on and win a close one, 53-56. This is the final exhibition game before the season opener on November 8th against the Maryland Terrapins. This is Sway Thompson, Seahawks Central News, TOTV.
Cedric Williams added 10 points and 12 rebounds in the three-point victory. On November 13th, the Seahawks traveled to College Park, Maryland for their regular season debut versus the Maryland Terrapins. Three Terrapins scored in double figures as UNCW fell 71-62. Maryland and new head coach Mark Turgeon only led by 5 at halftime. The Seahawks pulled within 6 with 2 minutes remaining. Adam Smith led all scorers with 23 points, 16 coming in the first half. The freshman proved he can play with the ACC heavyweight, shooting 5-for-9 from three-point land. It was the first time the Terps had played without former coach Gary Williams on the sidelines since 1988. The Hawks play at Dayton this Saturday and then travel to San Juan for the 5-hour energy Puerto Rico tip-off. They begin play versus Alabama next Thursday. The men's soccer team faced off against George Mason in their season finale on November 5th. Both teams had been eliminated from CAA tournament consideration, so only pride was on the line.
It would be the last home soccer game of the year for the Seahawks soccer stars, and none shone as brightly as did Sean Guderian here, getting the pass from Etienne Bollinger, puts it in the back of the net to make it 1-0 early in the first half. Guderian again here from Driver to make it 2-0. Let's watch that one again. This is a replay of that. Driver, Guderian, they are on the same page there. Guderian here looking for the hat trick, puts it past the keeper. 3 goals in one game, but GMU would get on the board there. Ryan Garcia makes it 3-1, then on the free kick, Hugh Roberts puts it past Brandon Miller. Miller had 4 saves on the day. However, Mateo Cardona looking for his first career goal. The freshman puts it off the head of a defender and past the keeper here. We can watch it again. Final score, UNCW 4, George Mason 2.
Guderian's hat trick earned him Colonial Athletic Association Player of the Week honors. He notched his 3rd, 4th, and 5th goals of the season, equaling his previous season high in 2009. He also won the team lead in points with 10. The hat trick was the first by a Seahawk since Devin Carroll pulled one out of his hat in 2008 versus William & Mary. In other soccer news, Brandon Miller and Daniel Roberts were each named a CAA All-Conference teams. The league honored Miller by naming him first-team all-conference goalkeeper thanks to 3 shutouts and a 70% save average. Roberts earned second-team all-conference at midfield. He had 1 goal and 5 assists in 12 games. The team finished 4-12-2 overall and 2-8-1 in league play. The women's basketball team rounded out exhibition play at home on Sunday, November 6th versus the UNC Pembroke Braves. Let's get to the highlights.
Starting things off with Alicia Andrews hitting the big 3 from way downtown. Now that will be a recurring theme in today's highlights. Here we have Tawana Lee on the other end. Bodies her defender, puts it up. No foul called, but she gets the bucket. Then Lee again on the fast break. The assist from Jessica Freeman. That's good. Then Carnesha Garrett on the floor, hands it to Alicia Andrews, flicks it back to Jessica Freeman, who drains the open 3. Let's watch it again from a different angle. You can see the hustle and the tenacity of the UNCW offense. Then Alicia Andrews again, I told you, one more time from 3. That's good. Then here Carnesha Garrett says, let me get in on the action. Boom, shakalaka. That's good for 3. Alicia Andrews again wide open for the 3. Final score, UNCW 55, UNC Pembroke 26.
Junior Carnesha Garrett led the way with 15 points and 9 rebounds. The team then traveled to State College, Pennsylvania to take part in the Lady Lion Classic. First up was Middle Tennessee State. Ayula Weaver scored 12 points in her UNCW debut, while Jessica Freeman and Abrea Trice scored 11 each, but it wasn't enough. The Blue Raiders won 72-60. The Seahawks' loss propelled them to a consolation game in the loser's bracket versus Washington State. The score was again 72-60, with the Seahawks falling yet again. Andrews had 16 points and Garrett Chipton 11. The Seahawks are now 0-2 on the season and play at North Carolina State on Wednesday, November 16th, followed by a home bout versus the ECU Pirates on Sunday, November 20th at 2 p.m. Switching sports, the UNCW volleyball team hosted two games this past weekend. Travis Sullivan attended both games and has a report.
The first game of the weekend was Friday night against Hofstra. Jennifer Mallard here getting ready to serve. And she gives a missile of a serve, but it's saved by the Hofstra players, and they set up a nice spike for the point. UNCW again with the serve. It's dug out and hit into the net by the Hofstra players. A scramble for the ball here. UNCW with one more attempt, and two Hofstra players go diving as UNCW gets the point. Hofstra with the serve, dug out by a UNCW player who sets up Jennifer Mallard for a vicious spike. Jennifer Mallard once again off the fingertips of the Hofstra defenders, who are able to handle it and set up another spike that leads to a Hofstra point. Sunday afternoon, they had their last match of the season.
Travis Sullivan here at Hanover Hall, the digging ground of the UNCW women's volleyball team. This afternoon, they face off against the Northeastern Huskies as they look to go 1-1 in their weekend of play after falling to Hofstra Friday night.
Jennifer Mallard here with the serve for the Seahawks. The ball ends up going way out of bounds, but it's saved and kept in play by the Huskies to set up UNCW here with a spike. Ball goes out of bounds, but points goes to the UNCW. Another serve here for the Seahawks, and it ends up setting up Nicole Bishop, 6'5" Nicole Bishop, with a wicked spike. Morgan Klein here with the serve and the ace for UNCW, which was very nice, but just wasn't quite enough. As you can see here, Nicole Bishop again with the spike.
Today was the final game of the season for the Lady Seahawks, and senior day for Emily Mormon and Kelsey Bindig. Unfortunately, they were not able to get the win against a strong Northeastern Husky squad that's ranked first in the CAA. They weren't able to win, but there are a lot of positives that they can take away from this game going into next season.
Thanks, Travis. Christy Late had 16 kills in the win versus Northeastern. The Seahawks finished their season with a 12-19 record, 5-9 in league play. In the final dual meet of the semester, the men's and women's swimming and diving teams traveled to Towson on the weekend of November 5th. Diving back into conference action in the CAA, the Aquahawks swept Delaware with impressive margins of 234-117 for the women and 245.5-105.5 for the men. Four-team defending conference champions Towson upended the Lady Hawks as Maddie Riley posted the only win for the Seahawks in the 53-3, completing a Seahawks sweep. The men toppled Towson 196-145. The Lady Hawks are now 5-7 in season, and the men have leveled off to stand 4-4. They travel to Fairfax, Virginia this weekend for the Patriot Invitational. And in one final NASCAR note, Tony Stewart goes into the final race of the season only 3 points behind Carl Edwards in the chase for the Sprint Cup. Casey Kane won on Sunday at the newly repaved Phoenix International Raceway, giving Red Bull Racing their second win in 4 seasons in the sport. They will be leaving at the end of the year, while Kane and crew chief Kenny Francis head over to the Hendrick Motorsports car number 5, currently piloted by aged veteran Mark Martin. Stewart and Edwards head into the final race of the season at Homestead Miami Speedway, knotted up in the closest championship race in NASCAR history. Stewart won 2 weeks ago at Texas, while Edwards finished second. Edwards followed that up with another second place at Phoenix to Kane, and Stewart finished third while leading the most laps. They have scored the exact same amount of points in the chase, with Edwards' only advantage coming from his win before the chase at Las Vegas. Well, that's all for now. Be sure to watch the race and keep on keeping on.
SGA will be holding a yard sale Saturday, November 19th from 7 a.m. to 1 p.m. in the Trask parking lot. Student organizations were invited to participate in the yard sale and allowed to keep the money they raised from sales. I spoke with Keith Frazier of SGA, who is in charge of the event. He said the yard sale gives an opportunity for student organizations to raise money, network with each other, and foster community. This is the second year Frazier has headed the event, and he said last year between 10 and 15 student organizations participated. The SGA table will be raising money for the SGA scholarship, which is given to a UNCW student who is active in the community and based on service, involvement, and academics.
Now it's time to hear what news comes from the big screen. Here's Chris Vickery with Critics on Campus.
Thanks, Janae. Welcome everyone to Critics on Campus, where we review the latest movies in the Wilmington area. I'm your host, Chris Vickery, alongside my co-host for the day, Stacy Pinno. As always, we did two movies this time around. J. Edgar is the first one we'll review from Clint Eastwood, who's done another phenomenal job directing. This movie is about J. Edgar Hoover, the founder of the FBI, and has a lot of elements of a political drama, but also delves into J. Edgar Hoover's personal life a lot in ways that audiences may not have expected from the previews. What did you think of this one?
Well, I thought both the actors did a great job portraying their roles, and they're very convincing. But like you said, Hoover's personal life, I was not expecting to realize that he was a homosexual. However, I thought the acting was outstanding, and they did a great job overall.
Yeah, it was something where I guess it was hinted at, and if you know about J. Edgar Hoover's life from historical documents or whatever, you would have expected it a little bit, but I was not expecting the movie to lean so heavily on that part of the story. But as you said, the acting was phenomenal. It looks beautiful. And overall, it's a good film to watch, so long as you know what you're going to see. Mm-hmm. Out of 5 stars, what would you give this one?
I think I'd definitely give it a 4 for the outstanding acting.
I would have to agree with you. Overall, a beautiful movie. I'm sure it'll win some type of award come awards time. I'd give it a 4 as well. The next one that we did is In Time, which is a dystopian sci-fi thriller where time is literally money. And it stars Justin Timberlake, where he is basically a poor guy in the ghetto trying to basically take down the system so that no one has to die before they've lived a full life. What did you think of this one?
I really liked this one. I thought it was a great concept, kind of how much is your time worth, and it kind of reminded me of a modern day Robin Hood, where he would take money from the rich and try to distill it to the poor. So I thought it was a great concept.
I'll have to agree. It was an excellent concept, but because it was such a great concept, I had really high expectations, and I don't think it met them. It also had a lot of elements of a Bonnie and Clyde story with Justin Timberlake and his love interest Amanda Seyfried in the film. Where they go and rob the banks together, and it was interesting, but the acting I don't think was very convincing. The supporting cast was what really stole the show, and overall it was just kind of a standard action flick. It didn't really grab me in any particular way, but out of 5 stars, what would you give this one?
Probably, since comparing it to J. Edgar and the acting was not as well, probably a 3.
I'd have to agree. It's a decent action flick to go see on a Friday night, but definitely not something that can match up to J. Edgar. I'd give it a 3 as well. Well, that's all for this week's reviews. This segment was brought to you by Carmike Cinemas. Stay tuned next time for more reviews of the latest movies coming to the big screen. Once again, I'm your host, Chris Vickery, alongside Stacy Pinno. See you next time.
Well, Seahawks, that's all we have for this episode of Seahawks Central News. However, we have one final note for tonight's episode. We would like to congratulate our amazing director, Nate Galluppi, and his fiancée, Harley Holt, on their engagement last weekend.
We wish them all the best and hope they have an amazing wedding and an incredible future together. So, on behalf of everyone here at Teal TV, congratulations to the both of you.
So with that said, remember you can keep up with Seahawks Central News 24/7 by stopping online at youtube.com/TealTV2010.
Be sure to check out the latest edition of The Seahawk and Atlantis at newsstands all over campus. Special thanks goes to the Communication Studies Department and UNCW-TV for making our show a reality. I'm Janae Randall.
And I'm Sarah Lively, saying so long, Seahawks.